They started with an artist in residence program, but when I got there, I changed it because it was only about one artist and one senior artist, a Yale, you know, graduate from Yale. William T. Williams was the first, but he wasn't, when I got there, that wasn't happening. So we brought in Leroy Clark from Trinidad, who was already in New York, Valerie Maynard run the printmaking workshop, Justine George from Haiti, James Phillips, who had been in NYUC, who's now, you know, trying to find expand on what he was doing. So we gave him studio space, and a couple other people. A lot of the artists that you might know as Where We At and whatnot, they did prints under Valerie Maynard at the Studio Museum, because we captured some more space than we initially had there to make sure that we could do some other things. And I, you know, this was done on a shoestring, believe me. Once the board saw what I was doing, and it wasn't like, you know, sucking up to what was going on downtown necessarily, but it was about finding what was there in Harlem. One of the questions they asked me at the interview was, for the position was, what do you think about bringing art to Harlem?
The answer.
Somebody already answered. You're in Harlem, you're gonna talk about bringing art to Harlem?
Yeah.
What about, let's expose the art that's in Harlem. And to me, Harlem was not just 125th to 145th or whatever. It was all across this land. And because Harlem was a metaphor for Black America and Black American culture. So thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Wish we could go on.
Thank you. We have time to answer some questions during the Q&A. Our next presenter will be Nestor Arturo.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's been a pleasure sharing this space with all of you, with our presenters in particular. I'm an artist, but I'm going to focus on a short-lived organization I started with Angel Garcia in the late 1980s. This was the facade of our building, 125th between 2nd and 3rd. If you can just go a bit slower so I can. The person to the right was our videographer, and she also became our administrative director, Elsie Aquino. To the right is Eddie Figueroa, who the last year, he was the founder director of the Nuyorican Village in the Lower East Side. And when he lost his space in Lower Manhattan, he asked us if he could share our space. So the last year he was pretty much with us, and he brought in our programming to incorporate more and more theater, since he was predominantly a theater person. This is Pedro Rivera, who's another one of our videographers, and Pedro Pietri, whom we collaborated extensively. This is Angel Garcia. Doesn't show him, but it captures his spirit. He had a studio on the second floor. He co-founded Eventos. Angel Garcia, unfortunately, is no longer with us. But I put the photo just to remember him and honor him. Next, you can switch. This is me. The reason I put this photo is so you can see the drawing board and you realize that this was pre-computer. We used to do all pacers and mechanicals. We had two or three activities sometimes a week. So the graphic department, which was me, was pretty busy in those days. Apart from providing services for Malta Moreno's organization and Museo Barrio, Exit Art, I used to provide a lot of graphic services for community organizations in those years. This is a selection of some of the flyers that announce some of our activities. Rose in Spanish Harlem, which was with Juan Chamsul Alam and Sandra Mayesteves. Music Mural was with Roberto T. Melendez and Jose Antonio Vasquez. Then we had Tobacco Row, which was a musical group. We had a series which is called Sojourns, which were artists traveling and bringing back their experiences and sharing them with us. And then we have the Americo Casiano's poetry series. Then we have Roca, who had a one-person show there. And at the end is a flyer by one of the Nuyorican Village's activities, which was these large musical spectacles that Eddie used to like to throw. either at that space or alternative spaces. Eventos came out of my disillusionment with creating objects for market. I created art, and I knew that few people in my family could purchase this artwork. So I felt that art should be more of a social activity. Inevitably, I realized that the creation of art is an innate need. The creation of objects is an innate need for you to project yourself outside of yourself. And I got back to creating quote-unquote objects. But at that point, I had this contradiction between what I thought was the purpose of creating artists, which was to sell, and I realized it couldn't be for that. And I created Eventos. Alternative Histories is an exhibition that included a lot of the alternative art groups in the 70s and 80s, 60s, and that was produced by Exit Art. Anyway, I created Eventos because there was no place for artists to experiment in our community, very little. There were quote-unquote the minority grants, so Angel and myself were veterans, but when we received grants, they were $15,000, where for everybody else it was $25,000. So I didn't understand the minority grants. As a Puerto Rican, if I lived in Puerto Rico, I couldn't vote for the President of the United States, and I could go to the wars, but I didn't get the same grants. I didn't get the same kind of money. So there was all these contradictions. I was a young man, relatively young man then. And Eventos was that need to create a space where we could come together, different disciplines. I want to get away from just being this artist, visual artist, and get into the social activity that art could be, hence the Eventos, which is events in Spanish, space for living art. I want to deal also with the language, the economy, so I wanted to really get into that and sink my teeth into that, how different individuals, again, it's not artists, but individuals in different disciplines could come together and address the issues that confronted them. It lasted, like I mentioned earlier, less than 3 years. A lot was accomplished. Represented is not a lot of what Eddie Figueroa brought into it. There was another member, Willie Colon, who was an audiovisual person who also contributed immensely to our programming. But this frustration of not having alternative spaces where we could go and experiment and do things together was the byproduct that brought about Eventos. I felt like I wasn't obligated to do art, but to feel it. It wasn't about creating art for a market, but creating art for a community and creating these outlets of expressions for this community. So there were free open houses on Fridays, poetry readings, we would have food, we would have a bar that kind of helped subsidize the space. And it was really a wonderful space that we enjoyed immensely. At that time, parallel was El Taller Borico and Museo El Barrio within our community, but we still felt alienated from the rest of the city, like the art world in the rest of the city wasn't ours. It slowly started changing, obviously now it's a quantum leap, but at that time it was a sad state of affairs because not only were we dealing with creating art and trying to be artists and looking for our particular voices, but we had to take ourselves and dedicate our time and our resources to deal with issues of survival, of equality, which I don't think was fair for us because other artists didn't have to deal with that, but we had to deal with that. So all the time and energies were divided, doing a lot of community stuff, and Museo El Barrio was an educational institution because we had a need more for an educational center rather than a depository for art, as Marta Vega well known. She was director of the museo at a very pivotal time of his history. And in short, Eventos, what it was a wonderful experience. I'm very grateful that Marta gave me the opportunity to share this space and time with you. And again, Eddie Figueroa is no longer with us also. Whose organization, the Nuyorican Village, was also a very important organization, a breeding space for musicians, Neto Torre, Jerry and Andy Gonzalez, the Salsa Refugees, all these wonderful musicians that play down there. And I need to mention Eddie because he's not here right now and he can't speak for himself. And actually after this, I'm going to have a round table reflecting on his life and his contribution to the Nuyorican Village because I think it was an extraordinary organization and needs to be remembered. He also was very instrumental in getting us inserted in Joseph Papp's Public Theater, which was quite a chore in itself and quite a challenge for him to convince Joseph Papp to, how would you say, finance and support his projects. I remember him always having these discussions and these fights with Joseph Papp to give him the same money that he gave other theater people, because Eddie Figueroa was also very concerned about developing a theater front in our community. So thank you very much for your time. And that's my story. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next presenter will be Carol Atlas.
It's kind of scary to see your face that big. good afternoon, and on behalf of Apple Shop, which is an Appalachian center that's located in the coal fields of Eastern Kentucky, I want to thank you for this invitation. It's really important for us to be here as part of this conversation. I worked at Apple Shop for 10 years, and I was on the board for over 20. And now I'm part of the extended family into perpetuity, I would say. You can't kind of leave. I was asked by Apple Shop to represent them today, and I am delighted to do it. Apple Shop has had a huge impact on me, the values and the approach to cultural organizing. It's had a big impact on the work that some folks here know me more for, which is the work I've done in New York with Arts and Democracy and Naturally Occurring Cultural Districts, New York. And I also want to say, Marta Vega, thank you. Another thing that had a huge impact on me was the Voices of the Cultural Battlefront conference decades ago. That has had a huge impact on me, and so we shouldn't, convenings like this are really important. They stay with you. So I need to say, though, that when we're talking about institutions in your own image, I'm not from the region, and I need to put that out there. And that when I'm talking about creating this institution in the image, it's of the Appalachian people, and I want to make that clear. And it's important for me to say that because there's a long history of people speaking for and giving advice and making images about all uninvited people in Appalachia that really misrepresent the region. And these misrepresentations are not just stereotypes, but they are used to justify the exploitation of the region's resources. So Appalachia, and these are just some photos here. Let's stop there. I want to give a little more background, though, on Appalachia. Appalachia is culturally rich and resource rich and economically poor. And Dee Davis, and I'm going to be quoting from people there so I can bring the voices of my colleagues here. Dee was one of the original youth that was trained at Apple Shop, and he's now the director of the Center for Rural Strategies. And he says, today Appalachia is regarded as the poorest part of the country, especially so in those areas that were blessed with rich deposits of coal. So how does the very richest become the poorest? Not by accident, not without a plan. And that plan was made very clear by a historic land ownership study that was done in the 80s that was who owns Appalachia. And it made very clear that it was owned by corporations and by absentee landlords, and that the wealth was leaving the area, and essentially it was a coal colony. Apple Shop started in 1969 as part of the War on Poverty, and Apple Shop is for Appalachian Workshop. And it's a training model that basically gave young people the skills that they could only use if they left the region. And the young people were interested in getting these media skills, but they didn't want to leave. They wanted to use them in their home community. So there's a great story of the young people basically keeping the equipment and rejecting the curriculum and creating an institution in their own image. And you know, given what I just said about the ownership, it was like, it was very important for the young people to have an organization they owned and to have control of the media. Dudley Cock, who directs Roadside Theater and is another longtime Apple shopper, he describes how Apple Shop really came about as part of the Southern Civil Rights Movement. And this is a time when it was important to say, I am somebody, my life is meaningful, and my stories mean something. And that was very much the spirit in which Apple Shop was created. And the Highlander Center, which was an important center that brought together, did multiracial training in the South, is a sister organization of Apple Shop. And in fact, when I went down South, that was the first place I visited. It was the Highlander Center, and I was very moved by the history of struggle in the mountains and the sense of being part of a larger social movement. And that really was one of the things, along with the funeral of the Free Southern Theater, that convinced me to move South and stay there for a good long time. Apple Shop's social justice focus ranges from environmental justice, and I was relating a lot to what Elizabeth was saying earlier today. You know, there's an example of young people in the training program who brought a glass of drinking water that was brown, from that's what they're expected to drink, to the state legislature and saying, drink this, I have to. There's examples of work that's about the women working in fast food restaurants, the rights of the labor or the coal miners, and about the rights of the prisoners in the supermax prisons that are put in Appalachia and where urban prisoners are sent. So Apple Shop has been around for 50, it will be 50 years in 2020. And I think it's really powerful to think about what you can accomplish with that kind of longevity, with an organization that's committed to social justice and community accountability over that period of time. And so, you know, you're seeing here the various programs of Apple Shop and the impact of being around on the art, which is very much about participation. It's about people telling their own stories and their own voice. And it's about the creators of the media and the theater and the other work checking in with the community, always sort of playing back rough drafts and making sure that it represents the stories of the community. Now, it also means that you can have a long-term critical discourse with your community. It isn't parachuting in, dropping a critique, and then leaving. It's about the kind of discussion you need to have. Wow, that does go fast. That you need to have with your community. So I'm going to run through something really fast because I really want to show a clip of a video. But so I'll just read this. I think that some of the other things that you can do when you're 50 is you can have sustained advocacy that can shift policy. You can nurture a new generation of leaders that have come through the youth programs of Apple Shop. You can build partnerships locally and nationally. And you can build networks such as alternate routes. You can shift narrative from one of exploitation to one of resistance to a vision for a just transition. And that really is the framework in which Apple Shop is now sustaining itself, is what is the transition from an extractive economy to a moral economy, as Helen Lewis, who's one of our mentors, says. And I would love to show this clip. It really shows for me the importance of place and the wisdom of community members. And I want to bring this to the table with the voice of the people in the community. And this is from an Apple Shop film, which is about a woman who resisted the strip mining of her land. And her name is Elizabeth Wooten. And this was part of an effort in collaboration with Kentuckians for the Commonwealth, an environmental justice group.
Now, Down in the valley, about a mile from me, where the crows no longer cry, there's a great big earth-moving monster machine, stands 10 stories high. Well, the ground he can eat hits a sight, he can rip out 100 tons at a bite. He can eat up the grass, it's a fact, but he can't put it back.
It hurts. Think you have to see every bit of this tore down around you. What's been done over there will be done just for a few dollars. And the dollars are spent. Now what have they got? Nothing but that unsightly seed. And their water all destroyed. I heard that woman say she was a fool for letting them do it. She said, oh, it'd have been like you. I'm a fool for what I've done. Well, I don't see dollar signs. I could use money, sure, but I get by. My land's still like it was. They tried to establish me a pauper in the courts. I guess maybe they think I'm a pauper. The lawyer asked me if I knew what the word pauper meant, of all things in the court. You know, that's almost degrading you. I said, I will beat you and I don't have to have money. My husband, when he was sick, he asked us to not let him. And you know, we are going to respect that wish, ain't we? What kind of people would we be if we didn't? People say to me, oh, why don't you just sell out to them? Get on the way and, you know, you could use the money. Let them go on in there. I said, ain't no way. As long as there's a woot and lives with this family, they'll not strip it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, our next presenter will be Dinga McCannon, artist and activist.
Today representing Where We At Black Women Artists, an organization started by myself, Kay Brown, the late Kay Brown, and Faith Ringo. The 60s was a time when the sleeping giant, also known as the African Americans, woke up and restarted screaming for justice, equality, and the right to exist. The arts flourished as Afro-American artists began to gather, create, and perform and promote our own images and thoughts. Whereas before the 60s, America simply said that we didn't exist. At 17, I joined the WayUC Artist Collective as a visual artist, the beginning of my career. When I joined the group consisted of brothers and a few sisters, but after a few years, the sisters kind of disappeared and it was just me. For a while it was okay, but by 1971, I began to wonder where the other black women artists were. I enjoyed living in a man's world, but there was things missing, and there were issues that pertained to me as a black woman that didn't necessarily pertain to the black men. Around April, I called Kay Brown, who called Faith Ringo, and we decided to find some other women artists. Oftentimes when we call people, we asked them if they knew any black women artists, and we were told that they weren't any. And we said, well, what are you talking about? You're talking to one. But anyhow, we managed to find 14 who came to our first meeting in my fifth floor walk-up studio on the Lower East Side, which at the time, the women really wanted to come to this meeting because I lived on a fifth floor walk-up. There was no lights in the hallway, and there were leaks everywhere. After a meeting or two, we decided to try and have an exhibition. We took the name Where We At Black Women Artists because everybody said that we didn't exist. So we said, where we at, here we are. Okay. We couldn't find a gallery at that time who would have us. Finally, Nigel Jackson of the AXA Art Gallery on Charles Street in the Village agreed to give us a show. Months later, because of the recommendation and the pushing of a lot of my men artist friends, he had reluctantly allowed me to exhibit in his gallery. And the feeling at the time was that women artists were not serious, we would run off, become wives and mothers, and not have long careers. The positive spirit and the camaraderie between us and the great response we got from the community after that first show inspired us to stay together. Thus, we became the first group and recorded group of African-American artists, women. Although we started with 14 women, over the years at various times we had more than 50 or 60 members. The initial 14 were Kay Brown, Faith Ringo, Carol Blank, Pat Davis, Charlotte Richardson, Nell Carr, Ani Millar, Geraldine Crooks, Maymay LeBeau, and Ann Tanksley, Jean Taylor. Where We Act consisted not only of visual artists, we were craftswomen. We had artists who did painting, printmaking, graphic design, copper repoussé, photography, sculpture, musicians, fiber arts, writers, teachers, and administrators. Although our main purpose was to collectively support one another and find opportunities where we could exhibit and sell our works and other ways of generating income so that we could stand strong on our own two feet, support ourselves and our family, as many of us were single mothers. We also understood that art can be a teaching tool and a vehicle for change. Our mission statement included that we existed as a sisterhood. That was the first thing. In unity, there is strength. To preserve our artistic and cultural legacy while seeking to unite humankind through the visual, performing, and creative arts, we are dedicated to the dissemination of information on the historical and contemporary achievements of the Afro-American artists. And we also wanted to support ourselves as well as inspire the women who would come after us. We became a not-for-profit organization in 72. And in 79, we received our 501c3 nonprofit status. We formed a committee who researched and found grants which enabled us to create jobs for us as community artists. We created arts outreach programs, survival arts programs for families and shelters. We did prison art programs at Bedford Hills Prison Facility. And we did arts and education at many New York schools and after school centers. We would often work with the YUC Artists Collective in exhibitions and other projects. We did a 6-story mural at 24 Furman Avenue in Bushwick, Brooklyn. We taught a wide range of classes, including painting and drawing, printmaking, crafts, writing, video, photography, needle arts, African mask making, making and using African instruments, stretching your food dollar through proper food selection, making your own baby food, the ancient art of natural beauty, healing arts, and so much more. We were basically a Brooklyn-based group, but we exhibited worldwide. A few of those places include the YUC Art Collective Gallery in Harlem, Metropolitan Museum, Local 1199 Gallery, Acts of Art Gallery, the Studio Museum in Harlem, the New Muse in Brooklyn, Bed-Stuy Restorations, the Cara Festa Festival in Guyana, Mega Ever College, and the Benin Gallery. Where We At stayed together for 25 years. Many of the artists went on to become master artists in their chosen field, and we all believed in passing the baton on and encouraging other women to rise up, defy tradition, and become artists. Although we are no longer in existence, our legacy continues. There have been other African-American women artist groups formed, inspired by what we did. It is for reasons like this that our story can be told in hopes of inspiring the next generation, because we basically started with nothing. And we managed to build an institution that really was able to do different things in our own communities, our own way. And all of this, and I'm here too, to make sure that our legacy is never forgotten, because America has this very strange way of revising history, and it's important, like most of the people who are here today have devoted their entire lives to make sure that African American people have a culture that the world appreciates, acknowledges, accepts, and it's on the same level as everybody else's culture. Oh, okay, and this is my work. In case you don't know, I've been an artist for 52 years now. I'm basically a fiber artist, which was another burden I have to overcome, because textile arts, which are mostly done by women, there was huge discrimination against that. Not only was were we discriminated against as black women artists, a lot of us were textile artists. You couldn't get into a gallery. They didn't want to see textiles. That was not an art form. It's about the fine arts. Not thinking that art is not put in a box like that. There's more than one way to do art. So, okay, this one is probably done around 90s. I've done a lot of work with jazz musicians. I love going to clubs and drawing because of the costumes and the way that they move and just the vibration. This is an old print of mine from, 72. Okay, there it is, 72. Because the other thing about me is that I have developed into a multimedia artist, basically because I had no choice. And not only did I have a choice, but I like to do more than one thing. I've been a writer, illustrator, muralist, painter, quilt maker. So this is the print. And the other thing that some people haven't mentioned today is about the cross-pollination of all these different groups. We all hung out with each other, we helped one another, we supported one another, we went to one another's events. A lot of us belong to one or more groups, etc. So that's it, and I have one more thing to say. I bought an actual quilt because I wasn't quite sure which images of mine you got. This was done in 87. It's of a woman drummer. One of the other things that used to upset me in the early 70s is that when you saw women images or paintings of women, it was usually a woman carrying a baby or something like that. And that's wonderful. I mean, I'm a mother. In fact, my daughter teaches at this school here. And but we are so much more. And part of the thing about where we at was to show that so much more. And that's my story.
Thank you very much, Linda. Okay, our next presenter will be Monica Montgomery.
Everybody, I'm Monica Montgomery, and I am the executive director of the Lewis Latimer Historic House Museum in Flushing, Queens. Lewis Latimer being an amazing black inventor that everyone should know about. And I also recently launched a mobile social justice museum called the Museum of Impact. Just to give you a little context of the Museum of Impact, we are aiming to create a cultural commons with interactive experiences around art activism and movements of the people. And we're building on this long-standing tradition of artivism, raising public consciousness and deepening connections and perspectives. So my version of what a museum could and should be: compelling, inclusive, and participatory. The images you're going to see in this PowerPoint are of people at the museum that we did in September. We recently popped up at a community gallery called Art Space in Harlem. They're right at 122nd and Adam Clayton Powell. We were open for 5 days. We opened on the day of the African American parade, so there was a lot of fanfare, a lot of excitement outside, and just inviting everyday people to come in the door, experience this art, see what we're about. Let me backtrack for a second and say the exhibit is actually called The Movement is Rising, and it's all about the Black Lives Matter journey and some of the horrible injustices that have happened, perpetrated against people of color, and ways that we can connect with that, find solutions, and take action. So this Movement is Rising exhibit really struck a chord with a lot of people, and it was my way of using the platform I had and doing what I could to contribute towards solutions in this struggle. So these are some images of ways that people interacted in the exhibit, not what you would see in an everyday museum. The artwork that we had on the wall was from a variety of different community artists, photographers, printmakers. We had artists from a group called Immigrant Movement International, as well as some people that are organizers that had been photographing all along their experiences at protests, and they were able to use those photographs and view them, exhibit them at the space. So on the left is an image of a woman who is of the Muslim faith, and she was so inspired by what she saw, she wanted to do her prayers in the space, and we welcome that. And I think it was a beautiful gesture, and I'm really happy she felt comfortable and able to do that there. In the middle is an image of an Aztec dance performance group that came to the space to purify it, sage smudge it, and do a dance honoring the Latino individuals that have been killed and hurt and slain with all the police brutality and vigilantism. And we were really happy to have them come. They brightened up the space, and a lot of folks walked in off the street to see what they were doing and what's this dancing about. And they performed for about 2 hours. It was very powerful. And finally, if you can see on the very right, one of my educators, her name is Betty Rose, and she's also a community organizer. She was inspired. We were there one night. We would stay open from about 11 a.m. to like 8 p.m. When we were getting ready to go home, there were all these kids outside, just like running up and down the street. And it's Harlem, you know, Harlem's a live place. And so they kind of ran up to me and they were like, "What's going on in there?" And I'm like, "We have a museum for you." I was like, "Ask your parents if you can come check it out." So they asked their parents who live nearby, and they came in, and the first thing they said is, "We're hungry." And I said, "Okay, I'll get you some dinner." So we got them some pizza, and then I was like, "Let's talk about this art." And Betty was able to just kind of like get their opinions on what they had heard of Ferguson, Mike Brown, Black Lives Matter, some of the famous and not so famous names that are associated with this movement, and really just talk with them. And it meant so much just to have a group of children in the space able to come up and see the art and make art with us and eat dinner with us and be in community and hold space for them. Like, that was the highlight of the experience for me. That's how I knew that what we were doing was powerful and needed and successful. Next slide, please. So another thing we aim to do with the Museum of Impact is inviting these cultural exchanges, making people from all walks of life feel welcome. A lot of times with Black Lives Matter, there are people that are not of African descent, Latino descent, not of color, that have come up to me and said, "Is it okay if I come?" And I'm like, "Of course, please do come. This is everyone's issue. This is an issue that everyone needs to be aware of, have consciousness around, and be working to find solutions." So we welcomed and invited all sorts of people. In that first week that we popped up, about 400 people came out. A lot of those were my connections, family and friends, but then they were also friends of friends and others who came. And this is another image just to me of like what a museum can be. You know, this community space, people are talking, sharing ideas, the art's on the wall. It's just a welcoming space, and I feel that the pop-up model is a powerful one. One of the reasons that I wanted to do a pop-up museum, aside from not being able to afford space in New York, is that you can bring the experience to where the people are, and you can share this art with them, you can challenge them, you can prompt their thinking, and you can activate them to not just being bystanders, but what I like to call an upstander. So we really wanted to go to places where people are and break down this barrier of the museum experience. You know, often in traditional museums, there's this like hierarchical, Eurocentric perspective that we definitely are against, and we didn't want any of that to be in the way of people experiencing the art and the ideas. we did a number of kind of community art making projects, protest posters. This one is called I Need Social Justice Because. So one of the nights that we did public programming, we asked people, what is it about social justice that resonates with you? And why is it important to you? And there's so many intersectional ways to get involved with the Black Lives Matter movement and issues around it. And so people said things like, I need social justice because the less you think about your oppression, the more your tolerance for it grows. It's really profound things. And these are things that we will collect, archive, and show when we go to other cities. We've been invited thus far to Ferguson. I'm going to a conference in Ferguson at the end of the month, and we're planning to pop up there in the new year. Baltimore, Philly, DC. And really, if you know of someone, whether it's a classroom, a community center, an art space, that would like the Museum of Impact to pop up there, please get in touch with me. We want to go anywhere folks would like to see and experience this. Next slide, please. This is the young man on the right is a young man who is a teenager. He's about 15 years old. He came that night all the way from the Rockaways, which is very, very, very far from Harlem to travel. And I was so impressed by him. He's a young budding activist. And he wrote, I need social justice because gentrification prevents me from seeing the world. And just had a lot of profound insights, asked if he can get involved and volunteer with us. And you would be surprised just the passion that the youth have and the ways that we can activate them and keep encouraging their growth. On the left is an activist named Dante Barry, and he is the executive director of the Million Hoodies for Justice Movement. And just a lot of great people came out. Carmen Perez from the New York Gathering for Justice, Tamika Mallory, several local activists and folks from around the country were able to come and see the space in Harlem. Another thing that I think museums can and should do, shape the narrative and rethink what does engagement look like. Community engagement is this term that's always bandied about when grants are ready to be written or if there's some sort of, you know, funder that has to be appeased. Oh yeah, let's talk community engagement. But I think it goes deeper than the surface. Next slide. So some of the things that we did to really engage community, we started this kind of letter writing transmedia project called Activist Love Letters. So on a table in a corner, we had people respond to these question prompts and write a letter to an activist, past, present, or future about their feelings of what's happening in this moment in history, how important it is, supporting that activist, showing that activist some love, or asking them questions. How did they get started? And we're collecting these letters and planning to show them when we go to future cities. So basically, each city will show something different, and the content will always grow and organically evolve. I've also been writing curriculum, and I have an Activist Love Letters curriculum that we're teaching right now to a group of middle schoolers. So I have some middle schoolers that have also been writing their letters to activists they know. And it was so interesting the other day when I was asking them, who's your favorite activist? A lot of people said, you know, names you would expect, Rosa Parks, Malcolm X. And one young man said, LeBron James. And I'm like, you know what? I dig it, right? Whoever's positive, whoever's an icon to you, who's doing good things in your mind, is an activist. Anyone can be an activist, and we want to spark that within people. Next slide. Some other things we did, audience evaluations. Basically, after people see the exhibit, if they were so inclined, we would get a video right then, right there, asking them about the art, the atmosphere, and how they plan to find their inner activists. We did a good amount of community programming. These are some of the activists that came and spoke. Next slide. I am a member of a sorority, Sigma Gamma Rho Sorority Incorporated, and Sandra Bland was my soror. She was an SG Rho as well. And her death hit me particularly very hard, when I found out all the circumstances, I couldn't even leave the house for a few days. And so in this exhibit, I wanted to honor her, especially in addition to all the other martyrs. And we did a vigil for her, and we released balloons in the air and did a good amount of art making around that. And these are just some more images from the week that was. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Monica. Okay, now our last presenter will be Woody King, producer, producing director from Michelle Theater.
And I got to talk fast, right? Okay. Concept East Theater in Detroit, mobilization for youth on the Lower East Side, the National Black Touring Circuit, New Federal Theater, Woody King, are totally inextricably connected. And the need for institutions in our own image was why these institutions work so well for me. Concept East in Detroit, 1960. Out of that, moving into New York during the middle of the Black Arts Movement and the mobilization for youth on the Lower East Side with the poets, Umbra poets all around, the musicians, Sonny Red, Jackie McLean, Kenny Durham, the artist Valerie Maynard, the artist Irvin Vincent, then moving out of mobilization for youth into the New Federal Theater, Lonnie Elder III, the great playwright J.E. Franklin, moving into New Federal Theater further, into Zaki Shange, Ed Bullins, Ron Milner, Amiri Baraka, Ben Caldwell. These writers, these artists, really came out of, more than anything, it's a deep love of Black literature and Black art and reading about the Willard Motleys, reading the Richard Wrights, reading the John O'Killens in Detroit because there was nothing else to do. You understand? Okay, so what I am really here to talk about, the need for institutions in our image. These institutions, if the leadership is African-American, then you will be able to produce a last poets. You will be able to do a What the Wine Sellers Buy. You will be able to do a Black Quartet and any Baraka you want to do. And no one can tell you you can't do it. Okay. Also, it also leads into the publishing of these writers by major American publishers, some secondary, some minor, some self-publishing. Also, to be able to convince the Motown Records to do poetry albums by Amiri Baraka, Black Spirits, or Random House while Toni Morrison is there. I believe that if a writer comes to me, a playwright, novelist, whatever, and I believe in the project, I can convince anybody to give me the money if they got it. If I don't believe in the project, I don't care how much they try and sell me, I don't care how much they want to get into the business, if I don't believe in the project, if it's not a cooperating my growth from childhood to my adult life, if it's not defining with a love of their relatives like I have for my relatives, I cannot do that project. It's the same basically with the Hispanic writers, Latino writers that I work with, Tato La Riera, Lucky Cienfuego, Luli Santiago, Angelo, Carla Pinza. Because they believed in what they wanted to do, I could find the money to get it done. Because if they sat with me and I said, wow, man, they believe in this as much as I believe in my blackness, you know? So we would have to do that. I also want to talk about the African-American institutions during the Black Arts Movement. Really, Roger Furman's New Heritage Theater, the Black Theater Alliance, the New Lafayette Theater, that's where I met Addie Mola. I met Ed Bullings, I met some of the, Sister Rashida Ismail said, we could communicate, we could talk, I could go and sit with the brother Ed Spriggs and talk about what I wanted to do. I could talk to Valerie Maynard about what I wanted to do. And whether she believed it or not, she would design for us. I could talk to Romy Bearden. I could get a piece to do a Black Macbeth. Because he said, wow, you want to do a Black Macbeth? I did a Black Macbeth piece of art almost 30 years ago. But this is an aside. When I put the name in Henry Street and all that on it, he said, you messed up the art. Okay, so I want to talk about this new study that was out last week about African American institutions that are sorely funded, but the conclusion on what should happen is, hey, they all should merge. You know, I said, well, man, institutions have different personalities, like different artists. Everybody, it's like saying the Women's Project should team up with the Manhattan Theater Club. Lincoln Center should team up with Kennedy Center. Oh, that doesn't work. I mean, they are different artists. Artists have different personalities. The personalities create great art. Adigna McGowan art is totally, totally different from a Valerie Maynard art. And I think we should have both. You know, the poetry of Rasul is totally different from the poetry of Amiri Baraka. Why should these institutions come together to, as they say, save money? My observation is 5 institutions will come together, they would get a little money, and they'll take the difference and give it to the white institutions. And I'm very, very hurt by that study. And I hope all of you read it. It's online. It came out from the Vos Institute, Michael Kaiser's Vos Institute, last week. And part of it was printed in the Los Angeles Times. Okay, now, my gripe, of course, is New Federal Theater, Negro Ensemble Company, and Roger Furman's New Heritage Theater was suddenly defunded on September 24th. These institutions have been getting funding from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs 25 or 30 years. So you say, wow, why did they cut my money? Oh, the panel did not know the work. Okay. Oh, the panel did not get a chance to see it. So I said, well, who is the panel? They're all white. They're not interested in what we're doing in terms of these workshops, not in the least. So therefore, the best way to destroy an institution is not check out its work. So that's why we all have to always be vigilant, be aware of why these people say they are cutting our money, our funding. We have to always be make them tell us, and then if I don't like it, they're gonna get about 10,000 letters asking them why. And they're gonna have to answer those letters or ignore those letters. We have to be activists because the temper of the times are not the Black Arts Movement, where if that happened during the Black Arts Movement, it would be a line around the Department of Cultural Affairs. Or if it was during the Civil Rights Movement, it would be a line around the Department of Cultural Affairs. But the activism, I guess as we grow older, is not picked up by young, new people coming into it. They have an unbelievable amount of debt with student loans, et cetera. And I got 1 minute with student loans, et cetera. And the system that perpetuates this, I think, did it deliberately to really stop activism. So activism is what it's all about. Question.
Thank you, Woody. Stay here. We're going to have all the presenters come up, and we're going to have a Q&A period for about 20 minutes. Now, think of this as like a press conference. You're the reporter soliciting information, not making statements. These are the people who have the information. You want to solicit information from them, ask them a question.
So, there's
there's a lot of talk about, you know, money and during the entire conversation. So then I was thinking of like, so this is my question. So should activism be aimed at kind of changing the government, changing the economy? Should it be aimed at that? Or should it be trying, like, should we try and focus on creating like alternative spaces that are out, that like operate outside of the government, outside of the systems that we're normally living in?
Okay.
Who are you aiming that at?
Yes, when you ask your question, would you specifically say who it's for, whether an individual or for the whole panel? So anyone would like to?
This might be a pipe dream, but in my thoughts, I believe that we as people of color, we need to sit down and start running our own institutions. We need to start fundraising in our own communities, and we need to be able to take control. Because it's nice when the government funds programs, but when the government gets to a point where they don't want to be so bothered, then we kind of left. There's enough money in our communities to fund our own schools, to fund our own organizations, to fund our own arts. It's the mindset.
I think that we need to get back to a model of community giving circles. And I spoke about this in the fellowship that Dr. Vega and her institution sponsored, the Innovative Cultural Advocacy Fellows. I feel like we have to become the change, the funding that we need. I pretty much self-fund everything. Not because it's easy, but because I don't want the fate of this movement, this institution that I'm building, to rest in the hands of funders that may not see the value in it. And so I hustle hard to get extra money to put into this. And that might not be a sustainable model, but I feel like that's kind of where you have to start and then grow from there with the communities that you're serving.
I just want to add something. I agree with you, and actually the work I'm doing now is very much an earned income model, but I think that it's our money that goes to the government. It's the people's money, and the people's money should be funding our work. And it should be the city money, the taxes we pay the city should be funding your work, and that's why we should be protesting when it's not funded.
You know, you're not gonna get any government money unless you're a 501c3, unless you have a cultural data form, unless you have a charity's registration. And unless you've been together 2 or 3 years. Okay, that's the first thing. The second thing is, if you or any of us try to operate outside the system through the Foundation Directory, through the Foundation Center, of the 25,000 foundation listings, 20,000 only give to Jewish organizations. So, what does that mean? That means the American cultural system is European, and it's going to protect Europeans, and it's going to support Europeans. The peer panel system is not a peer panel system that decides whether New York State Council gives you money, or Department of Cultural Affairs gives you money, or NEA gives you money. It's somebody they pick up, it's a friend or whoever, and those 8 people may read your application, they may not. If they're too busy, hey, you gotta be a part of a system. We've been around 46 years. And somewhere in Washington panel said, I don't know that work. That's the end of that. I don't know Dignan's work. Hey.
I was a panelist earlier. My name is Diane Freyer. I'm from the Native American community. And I just wanted to thank all of you and say that I was very inspired once again. And Mr. King, I don't know if you remember, but Hane Gigama from the Native American Theater Ensemble remembered you from many, many years ago. And when I told him you were going to be here today, he said to send his regards to you.
Yes.
We're hoping to produce the first Native American musical with my Amerinda, the Native Arts Organization, together with Hane in this coming year. So hopefully you can reconnect.
Okay.
A specific question to Ed, but then a kind of question to the whole panel. I wish you would talk a little bit about my first introduction to the Studio Museum was when you shared the space with National Black Theater. And I went to a reception that both of you were holding together. And I'd like to talk just a little bit about how that came about and what contribution it made. But I came today expecting what I got, which was a real opportunity to hear about my lived history. And an important feature of that, which was the symbiosis between social movements, political movements, and the arts. That symbiosis between the black protest movements and the black arts movement was critical to the success that it had.
Yeah.
I was glad to see those places where we begin to see it, Monica, like places like your institution, we begin to see it being recreated. But the thing that has not been mentioned that I think is critical to understanding where we have to go from here is that what was behind that was Frederick Douglass's comment, power concedes nothing without a demand, agitate, agitate, agitate. And we're perhaps too early in the Black Lives Matter movement to begin to see that demand bearing fruit. But I think it's important to recognize, especially for us elders, that we have to be present with those young people to aid them in understanding the importance of the demand and its cultural as well as its political dimensions.
Okay, so
and just talk a little bit about that whole thing in addition to Ed, that the rest of the whole panel.
Studio Museum initially was at 2033 Fifth Avenue between 125th and 126th in a loft building. And the landlord there was someone who lives wherever, but he had a front space running on 125th Street, which Barbara Antier and her company had been looking at. So he came to me one day and said, what do you think about this group coming in here? I said, well, you know, you're the landlord, but if it was me, I'd rent it to them. Because number one, we can share a lot of information, share a lot of audiences, and spread our efforts much broader. So he ultimately conceded to rent to them, and that's how that happened. But it was a sister organization, but it was also next door. Once they moved in, we can go through the elevator from our side to their side, but which we kept closed, of course, because we had a lot of different things going on for our development purposes. But we did a lot together, and we shared an audience. We shared an audience. In that corner, even though, you know, you might have had a Kentucky Fried Chicken or something, and the liquor store underneath the building was a cultural center. Around further up the street was Olatunji's theater. And that was a whole nother thing. So there was a sense of community and cultural community there, not to mention the theaters that Woody has talked about. They were all, we were all kind of in very much close to walking distance, close to the subways, and we shared pretty much the same audience. Woody shared that audience with us as well. He was just 10 miles away or so. But the spirit of it and the philosophy that we were working on with, however we came to it, whether it was through Du Bois, through Baraka, or through Robeson, whoever, it was the same. It was the same, and we all understood what we need to do, because we really looked at our history and understood how theater came out of into its own, how visual arts came out, because Harlem was also a center for visual arts. When you talk about the Harlem Art School with Augusta Savage and them, that was located on 125th and Lenox Avenue. I think y'all changed the name, but to me it was there. used to be a drugstore there, but it was upstairs over that drugstore. And few people knew that the Bearden and Jake Lawrence had studios down the next block, across the street from where the Studio Museum is now, before they tore that building, for the state office building up. So there, Harlem, that space in Harlem was really solid for cultural activities, and it was easy, you know, to get information from one to the other or to share information with your audience, which sometimes helped you grow your audience.
Okay.
I have a question. Okay, so I wanted to know, how can we combat, because I've been noticing with a museo and studio museum that these are museums and institutions grounded in the community and that made by people of the community, yet the powers that be take them. So would you mind giving some advice as to whether there are something that we can do or do stuff that Monica does, which is self-funding, like, because I feel like those are two museums that are grounded in the community that, to me, right now, don't mirror the community at all. So how can we, you know, reclaim that or make institutions? I just feel like maybe there's fear of institutions being built now and then 20 years later, the powers that be taking them away. So how do we combat that?
I'd
like to comment on that. I think the first thing is they have to stop being community organizations. They have to become part of the fiber of New York, the complexity of New York. The Jewish Museum is there. That's not a community museum. So if we stop looking ourselves in that perspective, that with this institution is servicing a minority rather than an institution that's serving all of New York City, I think we assure ourselves a greater funding, greater importance in terms of that fiber that is New York, because I think we have to reclaim our part of New York. We can't keep creating this alienation from New York and continue feeling like we're these kind of community organizations. And it's when this morning we were talking about people of color, ironically, and I didn't know about Apple Shop, the first thing that came to mind was Appalachian. I said, why? Those are people that are also being, you know, abused, alienated from society, and they're not black, they're not Chinese, they're white. So that, what's that? That's the powers that be, these echelons of power that don't see color. What they see is money and power. So we have to get away from separating ourselves and not try to think so much in terms of reaffirming ourselves continuously, because I don't think we should have to do that. We know who we are. But letting other people know who we are, letting that community accept us, and that we become part of that tapestry, this New York, the complexity is New York, the same way that the Chinese, the Italians, the Germans, everybody else, we have to become part of that fiber. And to answer your question, pull away from the syndrome of community organization and become one of the museums of the city of New York.
Yeah, but still at these museums, I don't see me reflected. And I don't feel that if something becomes, if you can argue that Studio Museum and El Museo are museums of New York, because if you go there, I don't see a portrait of myself. So I don't know, I just.
Well, the thing is that we're New Yorkers. I'm sorry to overextend this. We're New Yorkers, and I think we have to reclaim that right that we're New Yorkers. Equal representation in New York, whatever it takes. Not as ethnic institutions, I think our roots and our culture need to be preserved and protected, but at the same time, we have to be equal citizens in New York. What process that takes, I don't know, but we have to change our mental frames a bit.
Well, what we know is, what we know is, you're not gonna be appointed director of the Jewish Museum. What we know is you're not going to be appointed director of the Museum of Modern Art. You're not going to be appointed director of the Brooklyn Museum. Now, what you said, we should be able to fight that. You may become number two or three, but some white person is going to tell you that what you want to program once a year is wrong. So that is what I found. As long as I am the director of the new Federal Theater, no matter, I've done probably more award-winning white plays than anybody in New York. But it's a black theater, and that's how they define it. That's how it's written about. And if the New York Times or anybody come and they see a white play at my theater, it's got to be Woody is trying to pull something. What is he? It's not, yeah, it's a good play, but it's something, you know, he's got some ulterior motive, you know?
But I don't want to be misinterpreted. I don't think any of us want to be the director of the Jewish Museum. What I'm saying is that we stand up with the Museo del Barrio, the Studio Museum in Harlem, and have the same face that the Jewish Museum have, that we have the same respect that they have, okay, that we get the same kind of money that they got. I'm not saying that we want to become part of that or we lose our identity. I'm just saying that we should be able to stand on the same level that they do. The kind of money that we receive is in no comparison to what the MoMA, the Metropolitan Museum receive. What I'm saying is, if we get up and start claiming equal money, that we're not getting all these subsidies that they give us or these grants that we have to spend half the year writing proposals for, but that they acknowledge the importance of the Studio Museum and the Museo del Barrio and decide these are our museums and they deserve as much money as any other museum in the city. That's what I'm talking about.
I want to weigh in on this too, because speaking from Apple Shop's experience, hopefully being accountable to your community and representing your community and having the community see themselves in the organization and being able to accomplish an international reputation don't have to be in contradiction. I think there's often pressures put on organizations and rewards for moving away from your community. And I would like to see that flipped so that the reward system is actually on, you're rewarded for staying accountable to your community. But I guess what it would come back to for me is having a clear sense of purpose. And I mean, there was funding that our Apple Shop could get from coal companies. People kept saying, why aren't you asking the rich people in your community or out of your community for the money? But that would be completely contrary to our purpose. Plus, they probably wouldn't give it to us because we were making films that you know, were against them. But I mean, I think that's the trick, is to stay grounded on why you're doing what you're doing. And if it starts floating away from where you're rooted, I think you're losing your purpose.
Well, for Studio Museum early days, the process was a little different. As I mentioned, the board of trustees was already in place when I got there, and a program for bringing in art was already in place. I had to change that around, and I had to change that around by changing the board, number one, but also by embracing the culture that we were supposed to be representing, as you know, and the local culture as well as the national culture. So that was my program, was to as a museum, validate what the visual arts of our era was doing. And in that regard, we had a board that didn't quite follow that line of thought. But we had a board that had access to funds. Our position at that time was not one of fundraising per se. We did some things to try to make the raise money to do the programs that we thought we needed to do. Printmaking workshop, for instance, was not a part of that board's program. But when we decided by fact that there was a big desire for it in the community, that we should answer that. And so we scraped and created a way to pay the rent for the new space upstairs and brought in the printmaker, and the thing just blossomed out because people were supporting it. But in terms of the board was not the board that I would have put together necessarily. I probably wouldn't have known to put together in a different kind of board, but looking back on it, that board was not a board that was up, didn't have any kind of cohesion in terms of its ideology. It just wanted to do a museum. Some of us here knew Jim Hinton. We certainly knew Charles Hobson. We certainly knew Eleanor Holmes Norton, who was on the board, and a few others. Some of them were scattered in the backs of museums, Kennison McShine, a couple others, that were never involved very much in the museum at all, but they were their namesake only. So changing the board couldn't have happened overnight. But here's what happened. There was a board change. There was a board change because when I got the helm, there was and this can happen on any level in museums, there was a process by which the treasurer of the board, Jeff Byers, Lehman Brothers, now deceased, filed in 1969 the wrong way for the 501c3 as a nonprofit, which didn't allow them to raise money. And he controlled, to make a long story short, he controlled the treasury. I couldn't get access to certain things. So this is where the change came in. I brought in Russell Goins from First Harlem Securities, the black man, first seat on the stock exchange down here. Brought in a couple other people who had some status within the financial community. He expanded that to a man who was heading up Standard and Poor, and also one other person whose position I can't remember it now. But they happened to have been, they could force this guy to release, you understand? He had the control of the money.
I couldn't write a check
without it going to his accountant, okay? I didn't know this until I got there, of course. So behind the scenes, while we're building workshops and while we're having film workshops and while we're doing this, that, and the other, there's this other struggle that was going on, which I haven't even touched on. But I brought in this guy, Russell Goins, and some people hate him now because he turned out to be, something else as an art collector. But nonetheless, he broke that stuff up because the peers of this guy were now on the board, and he couldn't get away with what he was doing. That's how I did it, but I couldn't, we couldn't have put together a board that was gonna, for a studio museum that was gonna attract the Eleanor Holmes Norton or Carter Burden, or his brother-in-law, Jeff Byers, or some other people. But that's the way it was when I got there, so I had that to deal with. We couldn't go to the community as such, and they said, well, you're getting all this big money from these people. Even the black artists were saying, well, you're getting money from from the Museum of Modern Art. I said, man, you don't know the story. You don't know half of it. And I'm not going to give it to you now because you got an attitude about what it's about. It's not about that at all. For me, it was about getting our culture situated and getting us a voice in that visual arts thing here in America. And that was, what the driving force was. But, fundraising, I was on a New York State Council for the Arts and the City panels and stuff like that. And you had to fight on those panels because, here's to give you an example. Olatunji's place came up for funding on one panel I was dealing with. And the guy on the panel was from Syracuse, Buffalo. He don't know nothing about African drumming or the impact of that music in the world. But he's going to decide that, well, we just gave this group over here in Harlem some money, so we can't give them this, that, and the other. What do you do? So this is what you're up against when you go into that level of panel meetings. And this is the New York State Council on the Arts. So what you're about isn't necessarily what those people making the decisions are about. So who do you go to from there? If you don't have a community that's gonna provide the gaps when that you have to build up the you have to build on that. It's not something that happens overnight.
Okay, we're gonna take just one more question.
Can I speak on the studio museum and then the question? Okay.
Now make it quick.
Okay, it's gonna be very quick. I don't know if you all know, the directors of the studio museum have made statements they don't even believe in black art.
Right.
Okay. So now, yeah, the current people. Okay. So okay. during the 60s and 70s, Rockefeller's mama, Ford, and everybody, there were people running black institutions who did not even believe in black art. So what do we do about that? How do we deal with that?
I got the solution. Well, one of them. Museums are wonderful. I've had great experiences. I had some nightmares. However, as a response to from us being excluded from museum, there are hundreds of galleries in people's homes all across America. We need to go into those people's homes and buy some artwork. It's just that simple. Yeah.
Okay, with that, we're gonna go to the next and last question.
So this question is for Woody and Monica. As curators currently of organizations, kind of a two-part. I'd love to hear about some current voices or artists that you have come across, that current artists that you're feeling, and also just very, very quickly, some advice for individuals that want to maintain or start institutions. Woody and Monica.
I'll start. I have to admit, I'm always looking for artists and asking people, you know, who do they know and who do they like. And I don't have any art snobbery in me, so it could be someone that recently started or someone that's been around for years. Just yesterday, I met a great artist that I have been looking into, Sophie Dawson, and she used to do murals for Groundswell, and she did this amazing mural called Every Mother's Child that was up for a few weeks that had the mothers of Emmett Till and Mike Brown's mom and different people, and just kind of chronicling that, and I was so taken by that, and I told her, I'm like, I love your art, and I want to take it on the road with me, so, you know, there's someone right there that I just met. I'm always just on the lookout for just fresh exhibit design, fresh art. For people that want to start their own institutions, I say do it. Feel the fear and do it anyway. We have to build this next generation up in an institutionally inclusive way, and we can't keep waiting for validation or approval or any of that. If you have an idea and it's a solid idea and you say, you know, the world needs this and there's a void, go for it and be empowered in yourself. You're not always gonna get everyone to buy in to what you're doing. People said to me for the first 3 years when I was doing this, you're crazy, you can't start a museum, who are you? But here we sit.
In terms of young artists, young playwrights, and people working in the theater, Jonathan McCory, who works at the National Black Theater, Eric Lockley, who has something called Movement Theater. These are under 30. These brothers are brilliant. Further administration, Margaret Odette, who worked at the Ford Foundation, Kristen Adele, who worked at the Ford Foundation. These are all 30, 31 years old. These people are on it. These people are awesome. And I would suggest you keep them in mind.
I just like to add about starting organizations. There's a real alternative, the internet, setting up a solid website, and running your organization from the internet. If you have activities, exhibitions, or whatever, theater pieces, performances, then you identify the spaces, you rent them, whatever, for that particular activity. But the internet is a viable way of starting an organization. There's no overhead, no rental, no light, no nothing. You're just there, you get the input, the media mechanism is already installed into your website. So that would be my advice to anybody starting a new organization. Start with a website.
Okay, we're gonna have one more question, then we're gonna be finished.
I'm Melody Capote with the Caribbean Cultural Center and have done a lot of the fundraising for our institution. While we talk about the kinds of money, government money, that needs to go into our institutions, statistics show that the greatest largest amount of money that supports these institutions, all institutions, is individual money. 70% is individual giving. Our institutions don't get that kind of money from the very constituencies and communities that we're serving. My question is to Dinga. You said something earlier that said, we need to give to our institutions and support our own, and it's about mindset. What exactly does that mean? Because we've tried the giving circles that Monica suggested. We've done all kinds of campaigns. I know most of you know we're about ready to open a firehouse. We want to do a dollar campaign that says that if every person of color were to give to the firehouse just the dollar, we wouldn't need to ask anybody for anything. We're now going to be in city space. There are 34 institutions that get 85% of the city dollars from before DCA gives the rest of us the 15% that about 1,000 groups fight for. 85% of that money, 85% of that funding goes to 34 institutions. And only three of those 34 are of color. Studio, El Museo, and I think the others, the Jamaica Arts Center, Martha? What is it? It's only two. And that's because they sit on city space. The others include the zoos, the botanical gardens, the Lincoln Centers of the world. But there are only two of the 34 that represent organizations of color. 15% of that money, 1,000 program organizations, including us, and I'm sure Woody, we all fight for what's left. Because the firehouse now is going to be on city space, we're fighting to be the 35th organization that gets identified as what is called the CIG. They have now flipped how that happens. This is a solely mayoral decision. But because we've started to make noise at the city level about wanting to be the 35th organization, now they flip the script. So between trying to get the city to do what's right, turning to foundations who can decide you're the flavor of the month or not in their giving cycle that year, we really need to turn to the very constituencies and individuals that we're working with who aren't supporting us and who are giving a big donations toward the church. So how, again, Dinga, you mentioned earlier it's about mindset, and I'd like to hear a little bit about what you mean by that, because we've tried it all, and that is the smallest portion of the center's budget each and every year. Corporate support is the same. I mean, it depends. If it's a fun event that they can then come in and kind of do guerrilla marketing around, right? They want to have the Kodak name or the beer company. We don't take beer and cigarettes as sponsors. We just don't, right? They've been companies that have been so detrimental to our communities that we can't take that money, and those are the ones that always want to step up first.
Okay, I'm going to let Russell make a comment, and then we're going to have the panel respond.
One thing in support of add a dollar to your evaluation sheet. Add in a dollar when you're handing your evaluation.
Okay, would the panel respond now?
I'd like to start with you. Where's the ballot wrong?
Like I said, I'm a huge proponent. If you knock on the door and the door don't open, then you need to create your own institutions or something similar. The whole idea is for us as artists to have an audience for our art, to have a way of making money for our art, which is why, like I said, in probably the late 60s, maybe the early 70s, people started opening up galleries in their home. And not just in New York, all across the country. A lot of these galleries are very successful. To me, it works even better for the artists because museums, basically, they show art. It ain't nothing about sales. A lot of times your work is not in the gift shop, so you can have a piece in the museum. You can be poor. You may not even have coffee to get home. Okay? But these galleries, their sole purpose is to sell and promote black art. What we're actually doing is not homogenized, it's not what somebody else thinks that should be black art. It's what we, the people who are making the art, are producing. And so galleries in the home is another viable way of us being able to survive. I remember in the 80s, there was a black man who started a potato chip company. He became a millionaire about 2 years selling 25 cent bags of potato chips. I think the same thing can be done in arts with a little creativity.
Okay, with that, we're going
to end about that.
Our Q&A, and I want to thank the panel. Thank the audience. And with you refrain from coming up front for a minute, we're going to have a group shot. Okay, thank you very much.